So today is lecture number 9, apparently. We're going to turn our attention from, instead of DNA and RNA, to proteins, to what they do. And we'll focus on them for at least today and next time. Homework number 5, which was assigned at the beginning of last class, it'll be due as usual next Thursday. There'll also be a number 6 assigned on Thursday. Somebody asked, what was there a homework to be assigned pretty much every week? And the answer is yes. However, I said initially that there would be about 10 homeworks, and actually that will still be true, because there's 15 weeks total. We missed the first week, so that's 14 weeks. There'll be at least one time off for the midterm and one time off for the final. So it'll be like roughly 10. Just as a reminder, the midterm in class, October 20th, here's how you can prepare a little bit for it. And today, as I mentioned, we're going to go over protein folding. In general, the idea is you have the primary structure of a protein. What's the primary structure of a protein? The amino acid sequence. That's sort of a linear combination. Then you must fold up the protein, which involves lots of, what does it involve? Folding up a protein? Is it covalent bonds? Is it ionic bonds? Is it hydrogen bonds? Hydrogens? Hydrophobic, okay. We'll go over it a little bit. But knowing how the protein folds and predicting from the amino acid primary sequence to then figuring out how it folds is extremely difficult. In fact, it's basically impossible. And you'll see in a second why. So that, of course, makes an opportunity for professors to become, really good at it. And so there's a tremendous amount of computational work for physicists and physicist types in this. There's also a little bit of experimental work measuring how it folds. For this reason, next Thursday, I will be gone, and in my place will be a professor of physics and biophysics, Klaus Schulten, who is rather famous for developing massive codes. In fact, do you know what blue waters is? Who can tell me what blue waters? Yeah. Wait a second. Who's answering? Sarab. Yes. At the time, it was the world's biggest computer. I think now it's like the second biggest computer. And it cost like $160 million. And Klaus Schulten uses up like 10 or 20% of the time. It's amazing. In any case, he's trying to do detailed calculations to predict how a protein folds. Okay. Okay. Just to remind you about protein folding, we have a video.
Proteins are polymers constructed of the same set of 20 different amino acids.
Hold on.
The primary structure is a specific sequence of amino
Proteins are polymers constructed from the same set of 20 different amino acids. The primary structure is the specific sequence of amino acids specified by the gene. In the secondary structure, portions of the protein begin to coil and fold into unique three-dimensional formations. Two kinds of secondary structure units are the alpha helix and the beta pleated sheet. The folds and coils of the protein are the result of hydrogen bonds that occur at regular intervals. The tertiary structure is formed by interactions between side chains of various amino acids. At this stage, some proteins are complete. Other proteins incorporate multiple polypeptide subunits, creating what is known as the quaternary structure.
Okay. And remember, we studied different types of bonding. In general, there's the covalent bonds between the amino acids. That's what forms the primary sequence. In general, the covalent bonds are very strong and they aren't broken, except in certain biochemical reactions. Then there's a series of hydrogen bonds, where you can see between the O and the H. There's electrostatic bonds, ionic bonds between the partial positive charge and the partial negative charge. And there's also the van der Waals interaction, where you have lots of insoluble particles which come together and form. Okay, and this is again, you have the primary sequence, which forms an alpha helix, which essentially is just like it sounds, a helix where it has a bunch of hydrogen bonds. Then there's also the beta pleated sheet, or often just called a beta sheet, which is essentially goes like this and then turns around and goes like this and turns around. And this is stabilized by, again, hydrogen bonds. The secondary structure then forms a tertiary structure, which has the beta sheets over here and also an occasional alpha helix connected by, in general, unstructured forms. And then for some, you actually have a quaternary structure. Okay, so we're going to boil an egg. And I don't know, these were two that I found interesting. Oh my God, again, I catch you beating the children. And they're poached eggs, sir. We grabbed them when the chicken wasn't looking. Okay. But I want you to discuss yourself. And what happens when you boil an egg? And why does it happen? And you should do it in terms of molecular terms, in terms of the energy, in terms of the hydrogen bonds. You should talk about the energy and the entropy. You have an egg. It looks like there's a yolk, and then there's the white part, and then you go and boil it, and is it structured? What? You have to think about it. Go ahead, you have 2 to 3 minutes.
Yeah. Like if you're boiling it, I'm thinking it's more energy than entropy, like each individual molecule will be on a higher energy state.
By the way, let's say you heat it up. Hold on a second. Let's say you heat it up and then you cool it down at the end. Okay, go ahead.
Water, like water,
How you doing? You look a little lost.
So that means you can still be there. Actually, wouldn't that help the delta G be spontaneous if the delta G
forward? Okay. So let me have your thoughts. So initially you're at some temperature. This is the folded protein. There's a little bit of sort of unstructured, and then it forms maybe a beta sheet. There's a bunch of hydrogen bonds, then it forms an alpha helix, again a bunch of hydrogen bonds and another alpha helix. Okay, and then what happens? Go ahead.
We said that the entropy would increase because you're breaking apart a lot of the bonds when you're heating it, so it allows for more different states to be occupied.
What do you think? So you're adding some heat? And so these bonds are typically a few KT, T being room temperature, then you're having it bombarded with water molecules, which are now have a lot more energy because you're at a higher temperature. So these will tend to unfold. That's right. So, you know, so something that looks like this. So initially you have the egg white. Actually, it's actually clear, isn't it? And then you heat it up and then maybe cool it down. And then what does it look like? It's white. And it's solid. So what's happening?
Yeah. Since the procedure is non-reversible, is it possible for them to make covalent bonding between themselves?
Hmm. And that these are covalent bonds.
Between two R's, for instance.
Ah, between two what?
Two side chains.
Ah, very good. Is it possible? So then you're saying you have some other ones which it's going to form bonds like this?
Because if they're hydrogen bonds, if you cool it down, they should be able to return back. Because hydrogen bonds, they're reversible. If you break it and let it stay in their, let them cool down and let them stay, they can, at the end of the day, find each other and just like hydrogen bond again.
So it should be reversible. Why don't you have the egg white, which is egg clear, you heat it up, then you cool it down. It should be reversible, but it isn't. Why isn't it? The process of folding is not reversible, right? You have an egg, you heat it up, and you cool it back down. When you cool it back down, it's obviously not in the same state. Why isn't it in the same state?
You're continuing to deform the proteins. So it's not just like the electrostatic and hydrogen van der Waals forces that you're breaking, but you could also be breaking covalent and ionic bonds within the amino acid strand itself.
Okay, so the question is, are you breaking the covalent bonds? How much of these covalent bonds? These are like 100 KT. That's, you know, it's a lot. Mm-hmm. So you change KT, the temperature from like, you know, 300 degrees up to like 350 or something like that. In general, it's not enough. So in fact, this is still an intact. Yes?
I think it's so when you heat the protein, so the protein is like kind of like bunched up when it's folded, but then when you heat it up, it like lengthens out, and then it forms like intermolecular bonds with other copies of the protein.
Ah.
But the process is irreversible because it's entropically unfavorable for the protein to like refold with itself versus with like adjacent neighbors.
Say that again. What does it mean? It's entropically unfavorable for it to fold with itself as opposed to folding with other proteins.
Well, so when you add heat, that means like it's like vibrating, right? So then it's like, oh, like am I going to go like spread out or like come back together? And then there are a bunch of other proteins, so they're all like thinking the same thing, like kind of in a,
yeah, no, that's exactly right. So there's other proteins in here, which in general, this wants to form a hydrogen bond. And if there happens to be another protein that is here, this can form a hydrogen bond and it will form it. because the chances of it forming the hydrogen bond initially with this guy is basically very low, where the probability that this guy will end up, you know, happen to form a hydrogen bond with another guy is actually pretty high. Okay? Yeah.
Like, why the probability is very high? Because like if you have one strand of protein, you're like 10,000 strands around, and it's easier to bind with the other strands rather than fold up and find your like favorable position to. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's exactly the reason. There is a lot of other proteins which have amino acids which would like to form a hydrophilic bond, or maybe a hydrophobic to hydrophobic bond. That there's just a lot more states there. Okay? Okay. So in general, the probability of it folding and refolding in the way it initially was made is very small, very small. So somehow, though initially this protein was made and then will fold on itself to form the native structure. How does that happen? Why doesn't it form some other way? Yes?
Because when it's created, the strand is isolated in the cell, so there's nothing else that it wants to bind. There's no other protein that it's like, hey, I can do this instead. There's only like the one option, so it takes that option.
Indeed, that is basically correct. And we're going to model this in a very simple way, which, well, I'll talk to you about it. Okay. So basically what we're going to talk about is the energy landscape. Initially, it's the primary structure, and that then how it comes together. Okay, and there's a paradox. Could you shut off? Thank you. The protein folding, that is the process that results in the acquisition of the native structure from a completely or partially unfolded state. The protein folding, however, cannot proceed by a purely random search among all possible conformations. So this is saying, even if you have one of them isolated from every other, the chances of it actually forming the original polypeptide structure is very, very low. Let's see, let's do a order of magnitude calculation. This is initially a paradox, and it's called Leventhal's paradox. Imagine you have 100 amino acid protein. That's an amino acid. Of course, they vary in structure because they have different R groups, but approximately there's like 100 grams per mole, 100 molecular weight of an amino acid, and so 100 times 100 is 10,000 daltons. Okay, so that's actually quite a small protein. Okay, and let's say that you have three configurations in a step. A step being the amino acid, and then let's say the next amino acid, it can have three conformations. which is actually a reasonable number. Okay, so the question is, how many conformations could 100 amino acid protein have? Good, you have 45 seconds to come up with the answer. Good, talk to your neighbor. Do you know?
No. Like, yeah.
Do you, any of you know? Did I ask you? Good. Talk about it. You should be able to get this. Talk about it. Come on. Do you know the answer? 3 to what? Do you know the answer? Good. You know the answer?
3 to 1.
Did you hear that from her?
No, I said it.
One of them is probably.
You're the one who got the.
The
What's your name?
Josh.
Okay, so Josh, because he got the Ricola last time, he's volunteered to answer this question. Actually, he hasn't volunteered. I picked him. Go ahead.
3 to
100. How do you get that?
Each protein has 3 configurations. Yeah, it's just 3 to 100.
Okay. So 3 to the 100. So is this a big number? 3 times 3 times 3 times 3 times 3 times 3. Well, that's a lot of possible configurations, and yet that it wants to go to this configuration, that's 1. Now, let's say it takes about 10 to the minus 15 seconds for it to undergo 1 possible configuration. That is essentially the time scale required for a single bond rotation. So, okay, that's reasonable. So how long does it take to fold?
35 seconds.
What's that?
10 to 35 seconds, roughly. I'm like, if you assume that's like 3 to 100 is 10 to 50, more or less.
So this is essentially is equal to about 10 to the 50th?
It's 9 to 50. Which is,
yeah, so this is equal to 9 to the 99, right?
No.
9
to 50.
No. 9 to 50, because, yeah, you could write this as 3 to the 2 times 50. 3 to the 2 is 9, so that's about 9 to the 50th. 9 to the 50th is about 10 to the 50th times 10 to the minus 15th. Is that right? Okay, and so that's like 10 to the 35 seconds. Wow. 10 to the 35 seconds. So how many? Yeah, how many years is it?
0.6 to 25 years.
10 to the 25 years?
Yeah.
Wow. Yes.
When would it be cut down? So it doesn't have to go through each, like third one at the like. Doesn't have to do it one, then the other, does it? Can it do like multiple at once?
Can it do multiple at once? Probably. Okay. We'll get to that. But remember, this is for a small protein. It takes longer than the age of the universe to fold. But despite that, This thing folds all the time. Takes like a few seconds, or maybe it takes a few minutes. So something's going on here, right? Maybe it's doing it highly parallel or whatever. So we want to come up with a model that is plausible. Okay, so the question is, how does the protein go from unfolded to folded? A, at all? B, in about a millisecond, which is like the fastest kind of time that it does it? Of course, it's possible that it has help, that there are other proteins that are there to force it to fold in the proper conformation. And that those are called chaperones. And it turns out that most proteins can do it without chaperones. Chaperones are very useful, and eventually we'll get to them. Okay. So basically, we have unfolded to folded. And what we're going to do is we're going to follow the lead of Hans Fraunfelder, who's sort of the founder of biological physics. And we're going to make it very simple. We're going to take each amino acid, and we're going to make it black, which means it's hydrophobic. That is, it wants to get away from water. Or we're going to make it white, which means it's hydrophilic, which means it'll like water. And in particular, we're going to say that there is formation of intramolecular hydrogen bonds. That if you have a hydrophilic and a hydrophobic over there, do they like each other? No. In general, they want to be separated. On the other hand, if you have two hydrophobic residues right there, that they'll want to be near each other, because they can form van der Waals, or over here, they can form hydrophilic. Okay, so this is a very simple model. Again, if you want to actually do the real calculation, then you go over and, you know, you use Blue Waters. And you ask for tons of money. Okay, this is a summary of what we're going to learn with this technique. Proteins are made as a string of amino acids, supposedly unstructured, and then folds up into its state. It can fold and do so fairly fast, generally in a second. In most cases, it doesn't need help. That is, doesn't need a chaperone. In complicated cases, which are like big proteins or very crowded conditions, such as in the cell, proteins do get help. And these get help from other proteins called chaperones. This is the main message, that delta G is almost always small. Delta G is a combination of the energy and the entropy. The bottom line is delta G for the whole protein folding process is small. In general, it's like 5 to 10 kT of energy, which means it's essentially a few hydrogen bonds which are holding the thing together. Why is that? When you fold, the energy goes down. Why is that? Why does the energy go down? And same thing, the entropy goes down. So explain that to me. No. Yeah, you've answered. Somebody explain. From the egg being folded to ultimately being unfolded. Yes.
Well, the energy goes down because there's the hydrogen bonds, they're all binding to each other, so that's like a negative energy, and then as entropy goes down, it's a more structured way of, you know, forming the protein, and so. I guess that'd be the explanation.
Are you sure?
Just say yes.
Say yes.
Yes.
What do you think?
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right. Yeah. It was fine. It would be fine if you're wrong, but you're not. So if energy is going down and S going down, what is happening to delta G? When delta E goes negative, this becomes very negative. That draws delta G being negative. When delta S goes very negative, well, you have a negative, and that goes up. So the bottom line is the delta G is about zero, or if it was actually zero, then it would sort of be half unstable, half stable. But in fact, the delta G is a little bit negative. That is, it's 5 to 10 kT. So they compensate. So despite the energies being huge and that there's an energy of the primary sequence, the covalent energies, well, that never changes. There's lots of hydrogen bonds and ionic bonds and so forth that are forming. So the energy, there's a big change in the energy, but in order to get there, you have to go from a zillion unstructured forms to a single structured form. Yes?
I think in some previous reading material, you mentioned that if you consider the solution in the water, so the entropy still goes up.
This is not accounting for the entropy of the water. That's right. But it turns out that this is actually correct. And the total entropy, the total delta G is about minus 5 to 10 kT. This is correct. And we're going to see then the model, given that it is very crude model, it can recapitulate something like this. Okay, and the kinetics actually are pretty fast because there's not big barriers. It turns out for the kinetics, it's actually quite difficult. And lastly, the protein funnel is actually a good model. And now we're going to talk about what the protein folding model is. Okay, so, but if we step back, a typical protein folding equilibrium constant is about 3,600. So that what that means is you have the unfolded going to the folded form, and there's a certain rate forward and a certain rate backwards. The equilibrium is just the concentration of folded over the concentration of unfolded, which is actually the same thing as K forward divided by K unfolded. Okay, this means a protein is unfolded how much of the time per day? What do you think? I think you need some time. Okay, you have 2 or 3 minutes. So the protein is sitting there. It's going to be in equilibrium. It's sitting there folded. It's going to be in equilibrium with it, some sort of unfolded state. For now, we're just saying it has a folded, and let's say it has unfolded state. There's an equilibrium that it says, essentially, the equilibrium constant, this is equal to 3,600. It prefers being folded, but that doesn't mean the unfolded is zero. So in a day, what fraction is unfolded? Okay, so now it's confusing. So you have to work it out. I'll be right back. So, can I pick on you again?
Please. I feel like we missed something there. Also, when we're doing the little step problem, why would people think three of the 100 divided by multiplying it by 13, and then like one step divided by 13, and then like each individual step would be
added? Do you have the answer? What's that? Why do you get that?
Because the length of time maybe just equals to the possibility of finding that.
Oh. I probably have. Maybe I have it.
No, we actually discussed it.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we
discussed. What'd you get?
I think 24 seconds. Like 24.
24.
Yeah, 24 seconds.
24. In 1 day. Hmm.
In 1 day, 24 seconds.
In 1 day. Okay. So, anybody care to offer a guess? No. You already came up with the right answer. I can't pick on you. Somebody else care? No, I can't pick on you either. Yes. I have I picked on you today? Yes? Okay. Oh, wait. What is your name?
Tara.
Oh, you emailed me.
Yes,
in fact, I need to talk to you after class. Okay, Tara. What is the answer?
So I think it's once per hour, but I'm not really sure if my math's correct. What I did was I put 1 over 3600, and that's the same as saying like 60 seconds and then 60 minutes. So like 60 times 60 is 3600, so that's once per hour, which is 24 times per hour.
Which is what?
Well, once per hour would be 24 times per hour.
Seconds.
So, okay. I'm sorry, the coffee did not hit me yet.
No, no, you're generally, yeah. I think, getting it right. Do you want to come up here? Come on. Okay, so I bet you she didn't anticipate this. So let's give her.
And again, I just made up of it. And then. Maybe.
24.
Like times per day.
24 seconds. Wait, yeah, what?
Early.
No, no, you're doing just fine.
I'm not,
except I'm not sure how
not
you
exactly
get.
I'm not exactly sure where my units.
Ah.
Like, I think I get that this is like the general way to do it, but I'm not sure where these units come from.
That's true. Okay, so let's give her a hand. Good. Yes. Good. Yes. Yeah. You can sit down. Wait a second. Ooh. Thank you. I have one more. So she came very close. What there seems is it 24 seconds in a day or yeah. Seconds. So what? Why is it 24 seconds? Why wouldn't it be?
I mean, because we're saying it's 1 in 3,600.
Wait, Tara has a comment.
I guess I meant to say it in full 24 times every day. Well, we're doing
time, right?
Yeah,
so it should be 24 seconds.
Never mind that.
So what do people think?
It's just units. She's the numbers right. That's just the units.
How many? This would be 24 seconds.
It would be 24 seconds.
Seconds.
What? Why?
Because the equilibrium constant. So equilibrium constant will tell us what is the concentration of the product versus concentration of the day.
Yeah.
And when we are talking about the day, we are talking about time. 24 hours will have so much seconds in it. And then if we multiply that by 1 over the equilibrium constant, then we'll get what is the state where the unfolded state is. Be 24 seconds out of whatever seconds the day has.
Ah, 24 seconds.
So that means like 1 second per hour.
To 24 times per day, which is about once per hour. That's right. Whew.
How do you have the information of how many times per day it is? Like, it doesn't say that it's unfolded for once an hour, it's just saying that the ratio. So it could be unfolded for like a whole day.
It could be unfolded for a whole day, though this is the average. The average, it'll be 24.
We're looking for the average time per day, right? Average time is folded per day. Yeah, does it like on average unfold for 1 second every time it unfolds?
And I think it would be more appropriate to see it in an ensemble way if we have like 1,000 proteins or so many proteins, one protein will be unfolded instead of pan. It could make more, much more sense because these are concentrations.
Right. That's another way of saying it. Okay. So we haven't even gotten to the protein folding part at all. So basically, the idea is that it's born at t equals zero. It's mature in about 1 second. Then it's generally hard at work. Then it partially unfolds, comes back. It's hard at work again. And at some point, it partially unfolds. That is, the hydrophobic regions become exposed. And in some cases, enough hydrophobic regions become exposed, the cell looks at it and say, oh, this protein is unfolded. It typically will react what's called ubiquitin to that unfolded region. And then it says to the cell that the thing is unfolded and we're going to chop you up and in general reuse the amino acids for some other protein. So typically it dies in about 2 weeks. So for a typical protein, your protein is made, but after 2 weeks it needs to be remade. Okay, so simple calculation. K equilibrium, we're saying, is 1,000. Delta G is e to the minus delta G over KT. Let's say delta G is 7 KT, which is the kind of numbers that we're thinking. Hydrogen bond, so just a couple of bonds. Delta G is almost flat. Okay, we talked about this. So this, remember, you have big delta E and a big delta S, and they essentially correlate. Typically, the delta E is a hundredths of kilojoules per mole, which is about, ends up being about 33 KT per molecule. But that is compensated by the loss of entropy. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to say maybe the thing starts out with a lot of entropy because the thing is unfolded. The entropy is huge because it can be in one of, you know, hundreds of different configurations. In general, the energy is really low because the energy hasn't yet formed various hydrogen bonds. And effectively, it looks like this. And eventually, it wants to go here. The native state is here. The intermediate state is here. And the unfolded state is here. And the idea behind this is that qualitatively it has the right order of magnitude. So one thing is that initially when the protein is unfolded and then it falls into this, whatever this is called. And what if it goes like to some configuration where it's like this? And then it has to hop up in terms of delta G and then hop back down. Is that sort of thing found very much? The answer is, I mean, it's not obvious, but the answer is no, it's not. This energy, what is it? Is this the free energy or the enthalpy? That is just delta E. Delta E, why is that? Who said that? Nobody wants to take credit? Okay, there. What? Why is this delta E? Yeah.
Because since the free energy kind of depends on entropy, there would be a more clear, like, correlation between the two. Instead, it kind of looks like they're sort of almost independent, not quite independent, but it's a lot more.
That. Yeah, that's right. That's right. It's basically the energy or the enthalpy. And this sort of thing, this is called the folding landscape, the energy landscape of the folding, actually makes some semi-quantitative predictions. One is that it first can be fairly fast, basically because, you know, it's unfolded and then it falls down towards a smaller population. It's highly cooperative, meaning the intermediate states are rarely observed. It has a heterogeneity of starting points because each unfolded molecule has a different conformation and a different path downhill to be ultimately folded. Okay, and in many cases, this is coupled to translation, that is, to forming the, what is this? What is translation?
That's as messenger RNA is being transcribed into the amino acid sequence.
Yeah, this is basically a caveat on this. Often the mRNA is being read by the ribosome. And then as it's being read, it's starting to fold all the time. So this is somewhat of a sort of a caveat on this. Okay. So let's take the simplified model of a protein folding. We're going to say first that it's only 2D motion. Furthermore, what we're going to say is it starts initially, but then it can only be a 90-degree motion. Again, real proteins are 3D and are not restricted to 90 degree. This is a simplified model. And let's take a 6-mer, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And we're going to make it 2 hydrophobic and 4 hydrophilic, that each amino acid is represented as a bead, either hydrophobic or hydrophilic. The bonds are expected to be straight. And now this is important. That is, if you have a hydrophobic to a hydrophobic bond, it will be about 1 kilojoule per mole, which is about a third of a kT. And if you have a hydrophilic to another hydrophilic, there we're going to have about a quarter of a kilojoule per mole. And a single 90 degree rotation per time step is allowed. So let's see how this works. Oh. Okay, there is one other additional fact, that amino acids have a handedness, a chirality. That is, it has either a left hand or a right hand. These are not identical and not interchangeable. And it turns out that all amino acids are in your body, essentially all, are left-handed. In fact, if you go and synthesize an amino acid, it can be either left-handed or right-handed. Why your body only uses left-handed amino acids is basically a mystery. We don't know. One thought. Anybody have any ideas? Meteorites. They've found that they actually have amino acids that are left-handed. So maybe Earth life formed from an amino acid from a meteorite. They were left-handed, and then it all ended up, we're all lefties. Yeah.
And so the amino acids on meteors were, like, those don't just occur in nature, right? They have to be formed somehow.
Yes.
Cool. Oh. Question of why.
Right, now there's a question of why the meteorites were left-handed. You know, I don't know.
Is there something that prevents our bodies from using right-handed, like, is it like an either or and it has to be one of them, or is it just so happens that it is just one of them?
Yeah, when you have an alpha helix, it's always a right-handed coil. With left-handed amino acids. There is a steric hindrance for left-handed amino acid to be made from left-handed amino acids, and it's similar for beta sheets. So theoretically, we could have started with right-handed amino acids, and then effectively everything would be reversed. But the right-handed amino acids do not work with our alpha helices or beta sheets. Yeah.
I think there was like a little while ago that they made it and like both chiralities, like some pregnancy drug, and like the one-handed one was like really dangerous to the body, but the other one was like really helpful.
Indeed, that was, I think it was a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory that operated on both. Yes. Okay, last point.
I just wanted to know, like, what would happen if we had all right hand? I mean, like, is there any functionality or, like, any function difference between left-handed and right-handed proteins? Because, I mean, we can synthesize both of them in the lab.
Yes.
So we will understand the properties of the properties.
Okay, Josh apparently has...
We don't synthesize both. We synthesize the one we use.
But we're like, able to synthesize both.
We cannot.
No. What he's saying is, in the laboratory, you can make right-handed amino acids.
We can't use them. All of the enzymes that we have depend on that hand. Like,
so even if we synthesize, we can have the right.
That's right.
Yeah.
Our body is knows that it's left-handed. Now, I'm probably going to get in trouble for this. It turns out that there's a particular amino acid called serine. And in general, we use L-type serine. It turns out that in the body, in the brain, we actually have an enzyme that converts the L-serine to D-serine and uses that in specific chemical reactions. That's quite unusual, but it's what it is. No. I love these questions, but if we don't get to the remainder of this... Oh, man, just, all right, tell you what, although it kills me, okay, you have 2-minute break. Okay.
Yes, sir. I have a question about bond breaking.
Yeah.
So,
1 second, that's 38. Okay, go ahead.
For the first example with the egg, we're saying that we could heat up water enough to break like the hydrogen bonds and van der Waals forces. So if we assume that the energy of one of those bonds is just 10 kPT, and then the thermal...
For a hydrogen bond.
For just a weak bond interaction.
Yeah,
so it usually needs 5 to 10 kPT. This is an example. And we say that the thermal energy of an H2L molecule is 3/2 kPT. If we set those equal to each other, assuming that the water molecule can break the weak bond, that says the temperature needs to be roughly 2100 Kelvin of the water molecule to break that bond.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm clearly missing something here.
Right. You're saying that you have this bond that's, let's say, 10 KT, and it's coming in, and you're saying, in general, the proportion of water molecules that have 10 KT of energy is very low.
Right.
Are you asking about the 2100 Kelvin problem?
Yeah. Because clearly, it happens.
Right.
So,
in general, I think it happens for two reasons. That is an average 3/2 KT, and of course there's some Boltzmann distribution. And okay, so that can be one thing. There, on the other hand, in general, you have more than one water molecule. That it, you have several of them that can do that. So I think that those two factors are what does it.
Okay. Yeah, and I think also...
Okay, let's go. Okay, so in two dimensions, to avoid issues with chirality, all molecules such that the first two amino acids are going up. And also, the first kink will always go to the right. Okay. So, overall, there'll be no rotations. For example, this will be equal to that. So, we're not going to allow that. This here this 3, this is the same, and so one going up, that's certainly allowed. But molecules are only allowed to change in a single kink in 90 degree increment per time. Okay, so now you laugh about this. You're going to have to do this in homework. So initially it's in the so-called stretch state. Eventually, it wants to get to there, which we're calling the folded state. Notice, you know, white to black to white, white, essentially. This can happen. Now, how does it happen? It can do this. That is, this moves by 1. That, and then that, it's an overall rotation. And then this can go into this. How's that? It makes a single rotation. And then this can go into this. And you have to do this. This is fairly simple in the sense of it's only 6 amino acids. Okay? And then you're going to have to calculate what the energy of this is. The energy, for example, which is 0, W is 14. That is, remember, the entropy is the logarithm of W. So initially we have this, and then it can go to this, or this, or this. All of these are in there. Yes?
Do those arrows mean it's just like one step?
Yes.
Okay. How is it possible that it can move? I thought you said it can move by 90 degrees.
I'm not exactly sure what the question. This is one step, for example. Here it goes up like that, right? And now that is this. Remember, a 90 degree, a rotation of the whole thing doesn't count. It's the same. Yes?
That has a 180 degree. The one that...
Where?
Like from that second box? Yeah. Follow any of the other arrows and it's more than a 90 degree turn.
No.
It's 90 degrees the other way.
This thing.
Okay, good. No, no.
Which one?
Yeah. Okay. No. I hate to cut you off, but anybody who wants to stay afterwards will. I just have to get to this. I won't be here on Thursday. Moo. I know. Yeah, you're all. Yeah, whatever. Okay. So the energy is 0. There are 14 different states. So the entropy, we're doing this in moles, is R times the ln of 14. Here, the energy is minus 0.25, or in this case, minus 0.5, because in this case, you have two hydrophilic next to each other, next to each other, next to each other. So that's the energy. There are seven states. So the entropy is R times a ln of 7, which is this. Here you get a hydrophobic, one hydrophobic, two hydrophobic. So that's minus 1 kilojoule. There's two states, so the entropy is R times a ln. And then this is the folded state. This is essentially the same picture. Okay, now if you look at the entropy versus the energy, when the entropy is really high, the energy is basically zero, and it looks like this. So the folded state has the lowest entropy, and the unfolded states have the highest entropy. So it looks like this. The entropy is here versus the reaction coordinate. The reaction coordinate is just sort of a vague thing that says, here the reaction hasn't gone, and here it's gone to completion one. Then if we look at the free energy analysis, here's the reaction, it's gone, it hasn't gone. And you look at the delta G. In this case, there is, in fact, a downhill folding. At 298, that's at 200 degrees, but delta G minus, remember, is delta E minus T delta S. So delta G will in fact be a function of the temperature. And at room temperature, the folded state has the lowest free energy and therefore is the most energetically favorable conformation to be found. However, at very high temperatures, the fully denatured state has the lowest energy, free energy. So in general, it will roll downhill. Okay.